going to rappel in, but they told me I couldn't do that. Sometimes, the foot gets a bad rap. We all tread all over on it and don't even think about it. So my job today is to hopefully help you think about it. And I'm going to do it by telling you a story that's very near and dear to my heart, and hopefully that helps us to think about our feet in a way that will help us take care of them, especially for those who have diabetes and have extra problems, and we'll talk about that quite a bit. So there are some difficult things about having a name as cool as mine, and I'm not really a movie buff. In fact, I'm not a movie buff at all. But I have patients who are, and they'll come in, and when they know my name, they'll look at me like, what was it like to grow up with Ethan Hunt and, Mission Impossible? And so I've thought over and over and over again about how I would like to respond to that question, because it seems ridiculous that a parent would name one of their children Ethan and one Nathan, but anyway, my parents did. And sometimes taking care of the diabetic foot is a little bit like Mission Impossible, and so we're gonna use that as a theme. And I'm gonna tell you this story that is completely made up, but I think will be relevant to what we're talking about. So if you've done your research and you know the backstory to Ethan Hunt, you know he grew up on a dairy farm. And our dad had a few rules about dairy farming, and he insisted that that we have 49 milking cows at once, and that they were Jersey cows because they were the best, and that we milked them by hand. So Ethan's my older brother, and it was he and I's job to milk the cows before school, and I think really probably. My dad's explanation was that if we had 50, we were a big corporation, and if we had 48, we were just small potatoes. So that's why we have 49 milking cows. But I think the real reason was Ethan and I had gotten to the point where we could milk a cow in 5 minutes, which if you're familiar with milking dairy cows, you know that that's pretty much impossible. But with Ethan as an older brother, impossible happened often on our farm. And so we would be able to do that in about 2 hours, he and I, before school. So we started milking at 5 and we'd be done by 7 so that we could get off to school on time. And most of the time we just went right to bed because dairy farming is hard. And sometimes we would lay awake at night and we would just talk about our dreams and what we wanted to do in life. And one night Ethan said, Nathan, I'm going to milk our cows tomorrow in my school clothes without getting dirty at all. I'm like, well, how are you going to do that? He's like, you don't need to worry about that. I just need you to cover for me so that I can get it all set up so I can do that. I'm like, okay. So I get up extra early and start milking the cows, and Ethan's getting all of his stuff set up, and I get to the 48th cow, and he's like, okay, I'm all done. I'm ready. So he has one cow to milk, and he's like, I need you to get up into the rafters, and you're gonna help belay me down. He liked black even then. Sometimes he would wear really, really dark gray, but mostly black. And you see, he is wearing his earpiece, and that's not for me. He's not talking to me to make sure I didn't drop him, which I did not, by the way. Breaking into Langley base, it's, you could drop someone and still survive, but with 49 just milked Jersey cows that weigh 1,000 pounds apiece, that would have started a stampede and his life would have been really in danger. He's dangling on the end of the line anyway. So I did not drop him. We finished milking that, and the phone actually is so he can call mom. She really ran the farm, and she could milk faster than any of us. And if she had to come in and finish us milking up before school, we would get in a lot of trouble. So he's telling him, we're just finishing up. I'm on the last cow. And he walked in, was able to go to school, and school clothes, black, all of course, and they were clean and stuff. So here's the part that I think is important for us, is my mom was adamant also that we go to school looking presentable. There was no way we were going with manure on our feet or pants or shirt. So she already had a solution to that, which is what I had done beforehand. At the front of the barn, there's overalls and muck boots. So if Ethan were here giving this presentation, he would be telling you about all the dangling wires and lasers and super high technology things that we can do to take care of feet. But I'm just going to tell you about overalls and muck boots. So I hope that you all go home and can implement some of this stuff in your practices with your patients on Monday morning. It's all very basic, very simple stuff that I think will make a big difference and get the job done. So the diabetic foot is a real problem, and millions of people are hospitalized every year because of diabetes, and it's one of the major diagnoses on the admission record, and hundreds of thousands of those end up with amputations. It's a real problem, and that's something that as a community we can help prevent. So there's a group. Oh, and this is one of the problems. So this is a patient actually of mine, and came in with multiple risk factors, obviously for diabetic foot problems, and obviously this is a very serious problem. And even with lasers, we're not saving those toes, but we can save his foot. We'll talk about that a little bit later. So there is something I learned from Ethan, and that's assembling the team was incredible. You have to have a good team. And so congratulations. This is your induction ceremony. You are all part of the team. You're part of the Impossible Mission Force Diabetic Foot Screening Task Force. And whatever you're doing, if you're a therapist, if you're a radiologist, if you're in radiology, if you're a nurse, if you're a CRNA, you're going to see these people. You're going to see them walking. You're going to see them doing whatever it is that you do with them, and you can be part of that task force and help to educate them. So if your specialty isn't on that list, I'm inducting you now. You are part of our task force. You're part of the team. The International Working Group on the Diabetic Foot is an international group of experts that have done all the work for you. They have sources that are hundreds of papers long that are giving you best practices. And this is all free to you. You can get the PDFs downloaded and have these documents. They've divided them into all of these categories. We're going to focus really just on practical guidelines, which we can use, and prevention. This is the source, and I could include that on every single slide. This information is coming from their recommendations, which we try to follow in my practice, and I'll include it again on the end of the presentation. So those two papers, and they just give you succinct best practice guidelines that you can use in your practices. This is the risk stratification system. Obviously, not everyone is at the same risk category, and it progresses from zero all the way down. The higher the number, the greater your risk. Can you not hear me? Is that better? Better? Worse? Okay. So what we have found is the risk factors are additive. The more risk factors you have, obviously, the worse your chances are of having diabetic foot problems. And the two key ones are loss of protective sensation and peripheral arterial disease. And a close third after that is foot deformities. So those are all things that we can screen for in a very succinct, easy, quick way in our practices. These are recommendations for how often the person should be seen. This is purely based off expert opinion. There's really no data on that. And what I take that to mean is when I'm seeing a patient and I have a relationship with them, and we know if they go 4 months, they're gonna come back with an ulcer, that's way too long. We need to see them sooner than that. And for some people, it's 6 weeks, and we need to see them that often to prevent a wound from occurring, which then leads to infection, which then leads to amputation. And so that's what we're trying to prevent. And it's based off expert opinion. You were just inducted into the Impossible Mission Force for the diabetic foot screening. You are an expert, and you can help them to meet that visit criteria so that they're avoiding problems like what we saw in that earlier slide. So the first thing is visual inspection of your shoes. Simple. We all have them. We probably have all done it. You're looking at the top of the shoe. You're looking at the bottom of the shoe. You're looking inside the shoe. And you can look at the wear pattern. You can see that this shoe has been loved, and they're taking, you know, the tread right off of the bottom of the shoe, but still in, you know, relatively reasonable shape. But the insole is showing that it really has been loved, and it's probably time for this person to retire the shoe, no matter how much they love them. So what else are we looking for? And, you know, I'm really glad you asked, because I created my own iSpy, sticking with the spy theme, of things I have either personally taken out of a shoe or someone's foot, or they have taken out of their shoe and I have treated them for that. So obviously some of these things are more risky than others. This is hard to tell what it is. This is just, oops, let me go back. This is lint here, which we all have lint in our shoes. This is dog hair, which in Colorado, almost everyone has dog hair in their shoe. Occasionally, if you have a really wiry dog, it can be stiff enough that it will penetrate the skin and cause an abscess. I've seen that. Sand, we don't have a lot of people that go to the beach here, but I've poured a lot of sand out of people's shoes. One patient came in and they had a penny in their shoe. Apparently there's a superstition that if you have a penny in your shoe, it brings good luck. Not if you're neuropathic. I promise. Not if you're neuropathic. Take it out. By far, the most common thing I take out of someone's foot is glass or a needle or a toothpick. And that's why we encourage them to wear shoes. But I've taken staples and wires and nails and I don't know if I ever taken, actually I have taken a screw out of a shoe, but actually someone probably put that screw in there. It was embedded in bone. One of my favorites is this one, Hershey Kiss. So I had a patient that came to my office. She had been a longtime patient of mine, and we had treated her for gangrenous ulcers in the past, and she called in a panic. Dr. Hunt, well, Felicia, she called my assistant first. Felicia, I'm in trouble. I've got this big black spot on the bottom of my foot, and I think I'm in trouble. I need to get in right away. So Felicia got her in right away, and I walk into the room and immediately knew she did not have a problem, because gangrenous lesions do not smell like chocolate. So I walk over. Indeed, she had a big black spot on the bottom of her foot, and we scraped chocolate off the bottom of her foot, and she had clean, healthy skin underneath. And we got the rest of the story. She had been baking cookies, dropped one of these Hershey Kisses, and could never find it until we found it in my office. And she was okay. She got to go home with both of her feet. My other favorite one is this golf ball. I had a patient come in with ulcers all over his toes, all over him, terrible. And I'm like, what happened? He's like, well, I was golfing. I put on my golf shoes, and I thought, man, that my shoe's weird. Well, after 18 holes of golf, he took his shoe off, and the golf ball was there. So you can't fit your foot and a golf ball in your shoe at the same time and have a good result. So looking at your shoe inside and out, really important. And I tell my patients to do that also so that we can avoid that problem. Prevention is way, way better than coming in with a lot of high technology stuff and hoping to fix them. So visual inspection is key. The other part of visually inspecting is the insoles of most shoes today are actually removable. So you can take it out and then you can see if it fits your foot. And I'm gonna give you an extreme example, but if this were your shoe and this were your foot, that's not gonna work. And I can tell you there are people that are trying to put their foot inside of a shoe that is like that. And it's not gonna work. They're gonna end up with problems. And so with this foot, you can tell they have foot deformities, which brings us to our next part of visual inspection, is just looking at the foot itself. So deformities, hammer toes and bunions, put you at a higher risk for having a problem, especially if you have peripheral neuropathy. And here are the key spots, and you can see them. Dry cracking fissure here, red on the top of his big toe, fissure at the distal plantar aspect of the great toe. Classic places where they're gonna have problems, and you can see it on that patient. And then from the top, the side here also is problematic. In between the toes here, maceration and other things can occur. And so you just have to look. And if you see an issue, sometimes it's just changing your shoes, making sure your shoe fits. And sometimes it means we really ought to think about some sort of a reconstruction to prevent a problem down the road. And that's something that we can do. So looking at the bottom of the foot is also really important. So here we can see the beginnings of a problem. So he has callus and dry cracking fissure. And in Colorado, probably most of us should use some kind of hydrating cream to prevent dry cracking fissures in our feet. It's just dry here. If you have peripheral neuropathy, that goes up, you know, I don't know, 100-fold, because your nerves also control your autonomics. And so if you're not sweating, you're not emitting the natural emollients that our skin does, then you run into this dry problem. This progresses to a, you know, a full thickness kind of plaque of a callus on the bottom of the foot. Obviously not the same foot, but that's the progression. It's gonna move into this really thick, hard callus, which if that's not addressed, will lead to a blood blister actually forming underneath the callus. And if that's not addressed, then it goes on to a full thickness ulcer where all the skin is gone. This is down through the dermal and epidermal layers. And you can tell this person is not a first-time flyer. He's missing a toe already. So we address that. And that's sometimes it's as simple as removing the callus. Sometimes it's even more simple just by getting them to put hydrating cream on twice a day, morning and night, so that it doesn't dry out and get cracked and hard. Sometimes it means custom orthotics, offloading shoes, boots, casts, and that's what we do to help offload that. The gold standard is offloading so that they don't progress through this pattern here. So what seems somewhat benign in someone with neuropathic, this is where it can end up. So we address it early and prevent it from getting to that point. So the next thing is arterial. So here's some surface anatomy, top of the foot. You can actually, if you're looking closely, you can see the extensor hallucis longus tendon. Just lateral to that is where the dorsalis pedis artery lies. And then you can palpate that with your three long fingers. And you should be able to feel it. If you can't, then there's a problem. There's another major artery that's just posterior to the medial malleolus. Posterior tibial artery, and you can palpate that with your three long fingers. And you should be able to feel it. And if you can't, there's a problem. And if you don't have the expertise or the knowledge or the equipment to do an advanced vascular study, you refer them on. So ankle brachial indices, toe brachial indices, Dopplers, skin perfusion, transcutaneous oxygen measurement. We have a very sophisticated team here, and there are people that do this in the community, and you can refer them to those people. Heart Center of the Rockies does a great job, and then they end up, a lot of the times, they end up doing, you know, an angiogram, which with that first foot picture I showed you, that individual ended up getting an angiogram. They were able to open it up, and his limb literally was saved by a dangling wire inside of his foot that allowed him to perfuse. I saw him later this week. We ended up doing a transmetatarsal amputation, and he's almost completely healed. So for him, I think a real save. I think we'll be able to get him back to community ambulating without a prosthesis, and he has most of his foot. So referral to the vascular team. Screening for loss of protective sensation uses a very simple 10-gram monofilament. It's a piece of fishing line attached to a little screen, and you just bend it like this. So you just want that little bend to occur over a second. We test it in three spots, the great toe, underneath the first metatarsal and the fifth metatarsal, three times with their eyes closed. And we do it three times because people aren't honest. So you're gonna test it and say, can you feel that? And then you're gonna do a mock test, not touch his foot at all, and ask him if they feel that. And then you're gonna do it again and ask him if they feel it. And if they get two out of the three right, they have intact protective sensation, which means basically that they will be able to feel a painful stimulus. And that's the thing we want to let them know. If they miss two out of three, it means they won't. And there's a real chance that they could walk in with a nail in their foot and not feel pain at all. And so we tell them that. You could stand on something sharp, cut yourself, have an ingrown toenail, break a bone, and may not have pain at all, which they won't believe. So you just tell them every single time, because the reason they don't believe it is they have pain. There's neuropathic pain, and it's one of the horrible dichotomies of this condition. But they can't feel a real painful stimulus, and so we tell them that every time. There is a chance that you could really injure your foot and not feel it at all. The other way to test it is with a tuning fork. This is a 128 hertz tuning fork. For those musicians out there, that's a C. And you will test it on the top of their great toe, either on their distal phalanx or their proximal phalanx. And you do it the same way, three times, because they won't tell you the truth. So you make it vibrate, and you put it on top of their big toe, and with their eyes closed, ask them if they can feel the vibration. You'll make it vibrate, and then you'll quietly make it not vibrate and put it on their toe and ask them if they can feel the vibration. And then you'll do it a third time. And if they get two out of three correct, then they have intact protective sensation. If they miss two out of three, it's loss of protective sensation. And we need to tell them, you could injure your foot and not know it. So here are the take-homes that you can start this week when you start your clinics. We're telling the patients, this is your daily routine. This is stuff you can do to be part of your healthcare. Inspect the entire surface of your foot, top and bottom, in between the toes. Inspect your shoes inside and out. Take the golf ball out first, please. Wash your feet every day, hopefully. Use emollients, and you can do it twice a day. The only thing you would caution them about is just making sure they don't cake it in between the toes and end up with athlete's foot because it's too wet between your toes. But everywhere else they can be liberal there. Cut your toenail straight across. Do not walk barefoot. Do not walk barefoot. And unfortunately, you have to include that also means with your socks on. That's also barefoot, essentially. You have to have a shoe on. And then don't use any chemicals to remove calluses or corns yourself. So probably the most important slide that we'll go over is this next one. You are part of the team. Congratulations. Ethan Hunt, the super spy, is fictional. I did not grow up with him. And Mom still knows best. The mundane things really do work. You just keep doing it over and over every day so the job gets done. And here are my references. Any questions? Okay.